A very good afternoon, everyone, over here right now. And it's so nice to see you all again in another session of the School Synergy series. And today we have a very special guest with us, Zeba and Gomti. And we are very happy to have them today as an expert in today's session. So the topic of today is really going to be interesting. At the same time, is one of the crucial topic. Not only in social science, I find, rather in every space of learning, whether it is maths or any other particular subject. Inquiry is so much important, and it has become more important at today's information age when we are loaded with information, right? And so today, our experts will going to share their experiences, how the idea or the process of inquiry can be used in classes to have more quality learning together. At the same time, what inquiry is all about when we think of inquiry. So thank you so much, Gomti and Zeba, for accepting the invitation. Now I invite both of you to please kindly go ahead with your today's discussion. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much, Shadi. All right. I'll just go ahead and put it in presentation mode. I hope you can all hear me clearly. So, hi everyone, welcome to our session on understanding the inquiry process in social studies. I am Zeba and I have Gomti here with me. We're both middle school teachers in social studies and a subject that we're piloting at Gateway, which is called MLU. Along with this, I also teach language, and Gomti teaches environmental studies at the IGCSE section. We also have another colleague with us here, Candice, who is been a co-teacher in the MLU units, and she has also been an integral part of conducting one of the inquiry process units that you will see here today with us. All right, so before we go ahead with our session, just a few requests that we have for all of you here in order to make this session a fruitful one. We would love to hear all your ideas and suggestions, but we also want to make sure that the listening takes place well and everybody is able to hear what we're sharing. So as much as possible, try to keep yourselves on mute. And if there is something to share, you can definitely use the chat and we'll get back to your questions and your comments. The next is, I know sometimes the internet can be a dicey situation here, but we'd love to see all your faces here. So if you can keep your videos on and support us with that, that would be great. We'd love to see your reactions, gauge what you understand, what you're finding interesting. Like I said, if you want to share anything, please use the chat. Gomti or I will get back to you in chat, or towards the end, we'll answer as many questions as we can. And last, please, if possible, have a pen and paper next to you. As we move ahead, we will require you to write down a few things and share that on screen. So having a paper or pen next to you would be helpful. Lastly, please participate. Whatever you want to ask, whatever you want to tell us, please feel free to share that in chat, and we're here to support and share our learning with you and make this a fruitful session. So let's begin. The agenda for today's session on inquiry process is divided into three categories. We're going to take you through the what, why, and how. I'm going to begin with what is the inquiry process. So you have definitely come across terms in learning strategies such as research process or discovery approaches, project-based learning, even design thinking. All these are nothing but part of the inquiry process. And all these processes rely heavily on student-driven inquiry. It is very different from a teacher-driven project because here the element that stands out is that there's student voice that is involved, there's a purposeful problem, and there's a real audience that students cater to. The stages of an inquiry process, what makes it so interesting is that the stages in an inquiry process allows for the transference of skills across various disciplines and not only social studies. Today, what we're going to do is we are going to explore a basic outline of inquiry process, which would be a great starting point for any teacher or student who is new to this process of learning. We have simplified the inquiry process into four main stages, which is a goal, plan, do, and check. So what do these steps include? In goal, what you start with is understanding and defining the problem. Then you want to unpack that problem and find solutions for that. after you found a solution, what students would want to do is pilot that solution before presenting it to their audience. And finally, after the solution is presented, you want to go back to that and reflect on the impactfulness of that solution. Today, we're going to actually present to you two inquiry processes that follow the same structure of goal, plan, do, and check. And you'll understand how it's put into action in our school setup. Gomti is now going to take you through why. But before we do that, very quickly, just based on the gist of what inquiry process is, we would really find it helpful if all of you could take a minute on that piece of paper, write one word or phrase that comes to your mind when you want to describe inquiry process. It may be something from what we shared right now. It could be something that you had made a connection to based on your prior knowledge. So please feel free to use that paper, write that one word. And we'd love it if you could keep your cameras on and show it to us on the camera. And we could almost create like a Zoom word cloud. I'll stop sharing screen for this.
In case you are unable to switch your camera on, you can also type your responses on chat. That's also something we are open to.
Well, lovely.
Thank you.
Search. Yes, research plays such an important part in the inquiry process. Researching on the problem, understanding the background knowledge, researching probably on the background knowledge as well. Yes, completely.
I love the varied responses that we're getting on chat. Definitely, the inquiry process is very introspective because you are, like Zebas shared, you're not only researching the problem, but also looking back, checking if the problem, if the solution worked, if the problem, if something did not work out, what could be different or done differently. So introspection is definitely a huge part. Curiosity, absolutely. It does, spark curiosity. It does allow the child to work or develop their curiosity and actually get to some solution. Allows for a lot of critical thinking, a lot of problem solving. Independent learning, that's interesting. Mrinal, I wonder why you shared it allows independent learning, if that's something you're open to sharing with us here.
Yeah, Brindal, can you please unmute your and share why you have shared this particular point?
That's okay. I think what we can do is we'll be coming back. We'll be looking back at this and trying to understand if what sort of learning does your inquiry process really support. So I think we'll come back to that. But lovely, guys. Thank you for sharing so many responses. Absolutely allows for super active learning and participation in class. Absolutely. Filling holes in understanding. That's a really interesting way to put it, Ms. Aruna. I love that. Absolutely. It does bring in a lot of onus in the student's learning and gives the students a direction. And that's also something we'll talk about while we are taking you through the project, on how the students were very actively involved in every step of the process and how they also knew what they were doing at every point, which stage they were at. Permanent learning, absolutely, lifelong learning till today. I think both of us can vouch for this. Till today, we have students coming back and, you know, talking about the solutions and the sort of everything that they learned about in that unit because of the entire process that they engaged in. It definitely stayed with them. I think this is great, guys. So with that, I think Ms. Zeba, we can move to the second bit. It's wonderful that you all have now sort of an idea of what the inquiry process is. With that, we will quickly move ahead and see why this process is important. Clearly, you guys have already shared a lot of reasons and a lot of amazing skills that the inquiry process does allow you to develop, right? We are going to look at, to sort of understand this better, we are going to look at two problems that the students face throughout their lives. So we have textbook problems that you have students in facing in classrooms. So you have problems where they have to read the question, write the answer, versus problems that they have to face in their real life. Ideas that they face in real life, the different skills and resources that they need to use there. Now, we are going to look a little bit into the two types of problems a little bit more. In order to understand why and how this inquiry process is actually allowing us to build on skills required for the real life problem. Given that we have a small activity for you here as well, we would like for you to keep your paper and pen. You can turn your paper if you like to do this. This is going to be an independent activity. However, to do this, we are first going to divide all of you into two teams. Both the teams will then get two different problems to solve. Okay, so one will be a textbook problem and one will be a real life problem. Team A will be solving problem A and team B will solve problem B. You will be given 2 minutes to do this. We will now divide you into the teams, all right? Now, everyone in our group whose name ends with a vowel is going to be a member of team A. So you just know you're going to be looking at problem A. And all those who are in team B, that is all of you whose names do not end with a vowel, you are going to be in team B and you are going to be solving problem B. If that makes sense for all of us, if we are clear with the steps and where we are at, please give us a thumbs up. You can share a reaction so we know you're ready and we can go ahead. Thank you, Chitra. Thank you, Vinita. I see quite a bit of thumbs ups. Lovely. So I think we can move ahead and we will now show you the two problems. Problem A is, what are some strategies used to conserve biodiversity? So all the members of team A need to write down the answers, some points that you know that you can think of, and you can also start thinking about the steps that you're using to answer this, okay? Team B, your problem is to create a powerful petition against the infrastructure projects in Maulim Forest of Goa. Team B, you have to write down the steps in which you will address the solution. So you don't really need to create a petition now, but you need to write down the steps that you will probably engage in order to create that petition. You can think about the people you might talk to, the information that you might have, where you will get the information from, all of that. So the steps that you will sort of engage in. If that makes sense to all of us, and if we are ready to solve our two problems, we are going to start a timer for you, a 2 minute timer. Once the timer is up, we will discuss the answers and we'll discuss what went on behind reaching these answers. Yeah. Super. So with that, before we start discussing what you guys were thinking about, we just want you to type on chat, which problem do you think was the inquiry problem, guys? We'd love to hear from you. If anyone of you wants to unmute and share, please go ahead and do that. If not, you can all just type on chat and tell us which one do you think was the inquiry problem. Okay, I'm just waiting for the answers. Let me know if you want to unmute and share. Thank you, Ramya. Thank you, Marina.
Problem A?
Yes, yes. Please go ahead.
It's me, Geeta. Problem B.
Absolutely, guys. So I got a lot of problem Bs from all of you. You're absolutely right. Clearly,
may I add something here?
Yes, please. Please go ahead.
Yeah, so on face, yeah, of course, creating a powerful petition looks like, real life problem. But even if we look at strategies used to conserve biodiversity, can be a real life problem if we want it to be.
Absolutely.
For example, in Gurgaon, we are right now working for, saving biodiversity and especially Aravallis. So, what biodiversity is, looking for it, inquiring into it, visiting, having an expert talk. How can it be saved? What can you as a student do? What can you, how can you make your community believe in biodiversity and saving it? How can you involve politicians? So students even visiting the ministers to talk about this. So, it's how you look at it, So you can actually, both of them are very real life problems.
Absolutely.
It's how you treat them. They can both be just one class thing, or it can be both, can be inquiry based.
Absolutely, Preeti. Vinita, I know you have a quiet time, but just before I come to you, I wanted to add to what you said, Preeti. What makes problem B the inquiry problem in our situation is that problem B is absolutely contextualized. Here, we are looking at the problem in the setting of Goa, in that situation. So we are looking at it not only in terms of what are the different strategies we can use, but we are looking at it in a very contextualized way, keeping in mind the tools that we have available, keeping in mind the population we are working with, keeping in mind, you know, all those other little aspects that come into play, right? So that is an inquiry process, is that it is very contextualized. So you're right. If I want to make the make problem be an inquiry problem, I absolutely can. The only tweak that I would do to it is I would contextualize it a little more. So I think that's it. But I absolutely love how you shared and that's exactly what we're going to be looking at through this session also. We're going to look at how we can identify, there is inquiry process in everything that we are doing in our classroom, right? So we're just going to identify how we can structure that and how we can streamline our content and make it more inquiry driven. So it's great how you brought that up, Preeti. Thank you so much for sharing. Vinita, I know you also wanted to share. Please go ahead and share, and then we can go to the next part, if that's okay with everyone. Yes, Vinita.
Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. I agree with Preeti and Gomti. Actually, the Goa one is the micro one, which you also said that. So just as per the context or region is being referred. But when we are talking about the problem A, we are talking about in the macro level, actually as a whole unit. So it gives the preview in the holistic one that what are the strategies which would be actually in. Some strategies would be working for particular unit, like particular region, it would be beneficial, and for some it would not be in that particular region. So when we are talking about problem B, I would also say that the person, the group or the team or the individual who would be creating this powerful petition has to create a foundation. It takes a lot of guts and efforts to create all these things against the infrastructure projects,
right.
Obviously the Molem forest, if they have to conserve it for the beneficial of the future generations.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you for sharing, Vinita.
Yeah, yes. And even the people of the regions, the kids, the students, or the human beings who are living across that area would give us a true picture that what is actually the things which is creating this powerful petition. Otherwise, we are sitting right now in Gurgaon or Noida, and we don't know exactly. We have to do more here. So that's the thing.
Yeah. Absolutely. And research being the key word, right? Yeah. I think all of you, I mean, both of you have shared so much already about what we are going to discuss and break down in the next slide. What we were going to do ideally and what we are going to look at now is just breaking down and understanding four aspects of both these problems that we worked on and how inquiry approach allows us to address those aspects. If you look at the first aspect, we look at information, right? If I look at a textbook problem, which was my problem A, I wonder what sort of information or where you could have accessed your information from. I would love to hear from all of you on chat. If you would like to unmute and share, anyone who's done problem A, if you would like to unmute and share, where do you think you would have accessed the information that you got to answer that question or to reach to that solution? Please let us know. We'd love to discuss that. All right. I think
Gomti, actually, the thing which you have asked, actually, it's not very clear. If I talk about what I have understood from your information thing, okay. I'll tell you one thing. Like people talk so much about 2nd October as a national festival only on Mahatma Gandhi, but they forget another person who was born on that particular day. So when we are giving a text or giving a hint to the to the group of children that let's have an inquiry based on this particular thing that two Indian legends were born on the same day on 2nd of October. Right. So they can work on a full factopedia on both Mahatma Gandhi and Shastri. So it would be, so I'm talking about the information, just giving the birth anniversary and all that thing. But why they are two Indian legends in their own persona?
That is something I think, Vinita, I'm so sorry to cut you short, but I think what I wanted to address, and I think a lot of you have started typing on chat also, is just where we, what is the place that I would go to find my answer or to learn my answer for problem A, right? Problem A being the textbook problem, the problem, the question that's asking me, what are the different strategies to conserve energy?
Okay.
A lot of you have shared that we look at Google, right? And all of us at this point, that's our new textbook. We would look at Google to immediately get an answer to a question like that. It would give us those pointers. In school, our students might just get, you know, use a textbook or go talk to their teacher or take information from some other books in the library, maybe not. But that's probably how limited the information, access to information and even the sources of information that are being accessed in a textbook problem are. However, in problem B, like a lot of you shared, we did see that we are going to be like Vinita, like you shared, right? We will be researching the problem. We'll be talking to the people from Goa, the people who are native to Goa. We'll be talking to the government officials. We'll be trying to understand the problem better through really looking at so many different sources instead of just the textbook. We'll definitely even go look at Google. We will look at, understanding just what conservation is. We would probably read up about that. But in order to reach and create the petition, we will definitely also be doing a lot more research and getting access to a lot more information than we would in a textbook problem, right? Similarly,
sorry, Ms. Komati.
Agree.
There's a message on chat from Aruna where she mentioned we could get information from people affected by the problem to compare perspectives with the information available on Google. Correct me if I'm wrong, this would be problem B, right? In the inquiry process. So Aruna, just to address your question, your comment, when you get information like Gomati was talking about from people affected, that would be in problem B as part of the inquiry process.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Lovely. Thank you for sharing. And thank you, Ms. Candace, for clarifying that. With that, we go to this. So clearly, we see that the real life problem does allow you to access information in so many different ways, right? Apart from that, we have the second aspect, which is, Ms. Eba, can you move to the second aspect, which is the thinking. Like a lot of us already discussed, in the real life problem, our problem itself was so contextualized. We were not just thinking about conservation or different strategies as a list, but we were now thinking about how this list is going to be applicable in my situation. So thinking in my real life context is absolutely contextualized versus thinking for a textbook problem where I'm just answering the questions of what are the different strategies of conservation. That becomes a lot more abstract. I'm just thinking of the information that I have probably read on Google, read in my textbook. Again, when I'm talking about this, we are also thinking of ourselves as students, and we are looking at students answering and approaching these two answers or these two problems, right? So when students are approaching these two problems in a textbook problem, whether they've looked at Google or a physical textbook, the amount of thinking that is going into reading the question and reading the solutions that they have identified is not as contextualized. It's a lot more abstract in terms of the situation that the solution might apply to. The thinking is also memorized. So when I'm maybe in an exam, I'm writing the answer to this problem, my thinking is going to be very memorized, right? And that's what I'm going to do throughout my process also. I'm going to just memorize the strategies and then probably answer them. I might learn a little bit more about them, but the key would be memorizing over actually contextualizing my solution and working on it. So that is the other aspect of real life problems itself that are so contextualized, which is why the inquiry approach plays such an important role in allowing kids to develop those skills. Next, we would look at the type of resources and the type of tools that we use. Ms. Eba, can we go to that? Oh, before that, we look at the people that we work with. I know that I think one of you had shared why that it makes people independent, and that's what I had a question with. The reason I asked about that was because when I'm addressing a real life problem or when I'm looking at an inquiry based problem, the sort of people I work with, I never work independently. I work in collaboration, right? We said we will be researching, we'll be talking to people to understand the problem better. We would probably have to work with people who have worked with government or officials. We'll need people to sign our petition. So it's just such a collaborative of effort. And every real life problem that we face at the end of the day is a collaborative problem. It requires a collaborative solution. It requires a lot of collaboration to reach to the solution. Versus a textbook problem, a problem that we solve in our classrooms, it is a lot more independent. The work is done by the child. The child is working on it, probably with the teacher, in a lot of instances also with peers, but the amount of collaboration is not as much. Neither is it required in a textbook problem. Of course, we as teachers would try to imbibe that and inculcate that in our classroom, but it's not something that a textbook problem demands. Lastly, we will look at the type of resources and tools that we would use in these two different problems. We look at the resources and tools that we use in the inquiry problem or in a real life problem. We would require or we would access like so many more tools. We would look at social media, we would look at Google, we would look at, we would talk to people, we would watch videos of what's happening, we would probably even want to go and work in the area to understand the space. With that, I'm going to take you through the tools again a little bit. Like I said, the tools that are used in a textbook to solve a textbook problem are way more limited. Again, this is how the textbook problem is designed, right? I want to address on the fact I want to address the fact that in schools, teachers do take an effort to also make textbook problems more collaborative. They do make an effort to make sure that the textbook problem allows you to use more tools, use Google, research a little more to answer that question of conservation. However, it is not an authentic, it's not designed to be that. It is a textbook problem is not designed to be collaborative. It's designed to be very individualized, where one individual can do their own research and put their points down, right? Similarly, even the tools that we are using, we probably would use textbook, Google. We would reach out to a teacher, a peer to get our answers. Versus in a real life problem, you are collaborating and you're working with so many people that you are definitely going to use so many more tools. You're going to use the internet, so much of the internet, and so much more now that in the times that we are living in. You're going to be working on just work, making video calls, probably interviews. You would have conversations, research. So it's just such, it requires a student to just have so many more skills to be able to solve a real life problem. And when we are looking at our student, when we are looking at what we want our students to take back from our schools, we do know with where we are at, we want our students to go back with 21st century skills. We want our students to be independent when, like you shared, when they are out of schools to a school, to also be able to apply the knowledge that they have received from school and generalize it in their context. And that is where the inquiry approach really sort of comes in and allows us to address all these real life problems that come up, and it's addressed so organically in the inquiry approach. And that's why we are going to be spending so much time just looking at what it is and why we are using it. Now, what we are going to do is we are going to give you all a quick break. We are going to give you a minute to just stretch, to take a movement, to walk around and come back. When you are back, Zeba and I will take you through the two inquiry processes that we have done in our classrooms. So we'll take you through the entire project. We'll take you through all the steps of it, so that you have an idea of what we just discussed looks like in action. So before we do that, please go ahead, take a break, drink some water, stretch your body, and come back ready for the next bit. We will now take you through the how of the inquiry process. So we're going to take you through what the inquiry process looks like in action. In order to do this, Ms. Eva and I are going to take you through an inquiry process project that we have done in school under two different disciplines. So I have worked on an inquiry process under environmental management with students of the grade level grade eight, and Ms. Zeba has worked on an inquiry process under the civics discipline, and her topic was government. And she'll sort of take you through that. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to share my screen and we can begin whenever you all are ready. Give me a second. Just expand this also. Okay, lovely. So here goes. The inquiry project that we did in my classroom was one on energy conservation. Our focus question that the students worked on was, how do we conserve energy in Gateway? If you look here in your screen, we have divided the inquiry process into four stages. So we have the goal, plan, do, check, like Ms. Eba shared with you in the what space, and you will get to see what that looks like in action now. I also want to share with you that the tool that you're seeing in front of you is a Prezi. This is a tool that allows you to sort of have a visual representation of all the stages, right? And we used a different, a modified Prezi with our students to allow them also to know at all times which stage of the process they were in and what they were doing. And it also allowed them to make connections at every stage. Lovely. So with that, we will go to the goal. One second. I'm so sorry about this. Give me a second. Hold on. Can I just, sorry, I'm so sorry about that. Okay, with that, we'll go to the first stage, which is the goal stage. The goal stage, like you see here, was divided into four sub-stages. The first bit of the goal stage was building background knowledge. Here, the students first spoke to each other, shared information that they already had about what conservation means. So they discussed using the parent share strategy, like you will see in the video here. The students also represented what they already knew and their learning from reading up from discussions on this worksheet that you see in front of you. So we're going to show you a little sample of how the students first build background knowledge on what conservation means. All right, I have to share my sound. I would like for you all to give me a thumbs up or just give me an indication if you can hear the sound as well.
Used to pretend the earth is from the farming or destruction. Because humans don't waste the garbage and save and make
कुछ करोगे ऐसा पोल्यूशन तो
वॉट इज कंजर्व
That we save energy and greenery from pollution and bad things, right? Yeah. So we don't waste.
And pollution is bad for the earth, right?
Yeah.
Conserve for me means recycle, like recycle water, recycle greenery. What does conserve mean for you?
Conserve means to me to protect something very important for the next generation.
Ask a question.
Sustainable energy.
Okay, and how is your
and keeping our country clean and telling us that to keep our country clean and everything good stuff. Okay. Now what? So now you can tell me. What is your opinion to
conserve?
Conserve.
My opinion to conserve is to store energy in a box and for the future we can use it.
Good job.
So with that, that was a quick video on what the kids did in their classroom. And having discussed that in the parent share method, they also defined, they put it down in the worksheet. So they put their learnings down in a worksheet of just what conservation means to them. They represented their learning in various ways, not only through words, but also just drawing and expressing what they
I'm just
waiting for everyone to go on mute. Thank you so much. Lovely. With that, we went on to continue building a little bit more background knowledge of conservation. This we did through, in giving them information. So we shared videos, we spoke to them about conservation, we looked at textbooks. Here's where you would use to sort of look at your textbook and build in that extra background knowledge, the content information about, conservation or about the subject, the topic that you are doing. When we did that, the students identified two big reasons why they needed to conserve energy and why it was important to conserve energy. The two reasons that they came up with was one, to reduce global warming, and the other one was to control the extinction of fossil fuels. Now, having identified why it was important to conserve energy, having understood what conservation means, the students then went on to understanding what success in conservation of energy looks like. So what a successful project of conserving energy looks like in a different setting. For this, the students read up a little bit of information about the news, about different school where they had actually conserved energy, which was an eco-friendly school. They looked at what that meant. They brainstormed how that looked like in their school. And what then they then sort of put down together ideas and discussed what it would mean like for Gateway to be successful at conserving energy, Gateway being their school. Here you see a video of the students sharing their opinions.
Our school roof should be full of solar panels.
We don't have zero electricity bills.
Energy, then the school will not only be the first eco-friendly school in the world, but it will also be the first power conservation school, because if solar energy is used, then fossil fuel won't be needed and it will be saved.
With that, the students now identified what they needed to know and what they already knew about the problem in their context. So now what they had already finished doing is building all the background knowledge that they needed for their problem. They identified, they gained content knowledge, they looked at what successful, solution in a different setting looks like. And then they also thought about, maybe this is what a successful situation in my setting would look like. Having done that, they came into their own setting and they said, let's sit and identify and understand my setting a little bit better. So they went on to researching their problem in their setting. Here, the students did a 2-paisa protocol, which they used to discuss with each other how they can, what they already know about how school conserves energy and what they needed to know about how school conserves energy to be able to then define their problem properly. Here, they're still identifying and doing all this research to be able to define their final problem, define the problem that they're going to be working on later in the do stage. Now, to do this, the students in the 2-paisa strategy protocol, like you will see in this video, the students get 2 turns. So there are 2 rounds. And in each round, the student gets a turn to share what they know. The second round, the students share what they want to know. This protocol allows students to, one, develop just waiting skills and also allows every child to get a chance to participate. You can watch the video here.
What I know about Gateway is that about saving electricity is like we have made big holes over this, that the sunlight can come easily. And the grandstand has a huge hole in between, so wherever you go, it's like an open space, so you have lots of light coming.
I need to know how much fossil fuels we use make electricity in the school.
Having done that, they put down their ideas, whatever they had discussed, in a sheet like this. And the interesting things that sort of came out is the few things that they wanted to learn more about was how much electricity was used in school. How do we use our electrical appliances? Do we switch them on or not? Or do we switch them off or not when they're not in use? Also, what the school's electricity bill was like. Now, having jotted down all this, they moved to identify ways to be able to reach this solution, to be able to understand or learn this information. They did this by collecting data in three different ways. They interpreted and analyzed that data to be able to get the to be able to get the answers to their questions. The three things that the students looked into, one was the school expense data. They also spoke to the teachers and the staff members to understand them their idea of conservation of energy in school and what they knew about conservation of energy in school through a staff survey. And finally, they looked at the electricity bills in school in order to understand what the expenses look like and analyze what that tells them about energy consumption in school. Here, you see the students sort of looking at the electricity bill. They have already collected the data here. They are analyzing and interpreting it. And this is a small video of what they have found out of it.
And that month is much higher than 2014 March, and that's why it is the most highest year and highest month.
Wow, yeah, you're right. So
2017. Okay, now I'll see. I can see there's
an increase. I'm Miss Madhuri.
Yeah, I can see a decrease and. Let me say, I can see a decrease in June. Yeah, I.
Where is I? We don't know.
They also looked at the survey questions that they had asked their teachers to understand a little bit more about the questions that they wanted answered before they could define their goal. If you look here, the students have written down their own survey questions, keeping in mind the things that they want to know about. They then tallied all the responses that they got and analyzed that and understood what that means about energy consumption in school. Here's a quick video of what they were doing.
What are the things that the teachers doing?
Careful and precautions.
It did not like that fan will not be
required. But like, how do you know that? Like, because of 2017, because 2017 was stored
Through using these tools, the students were able to successfully gain perspectives of all the stakeholders at Gateway who were part of the problem and the solution of conserving energy at Gateway. So it started from their own classroom, that was the squad and their teachers, to all the way up to the trustees and the principals of school. So they were able to gather all their, all of their perspectives. And finally, having really researched the problem in their own context, as well as just learned about the problem in a generalized setting, they were able to define what they wanted to finally work on. The problem that you see here that they wanted to work on was, even though most teachers and students believe that it is their duty to conserve energy at school and know the basic ways to do so, electricity conservation at school is increasing every year. It is the third highest expense in school. What can we do to further conserve energy in school? So this now was what they were going to work on, what they were going to find solutions for and work on those solutions on. Before we move ahead, we have a very quick poll for you just to see if this makes sense. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen for a second. And Ms. Zeba is going to start the poll. Ms. Zeba, are you starting the poll? Oh, perfect. It is already on your screens. So guys, you must have a poll on your screens. You can read we can read the question for you and you can click the answer that you think is most correct. We will stop the poll once we get a few participants who've shared. So the question is, which of the following is not a part of the goal stage in saving electricity project, saving Gateway's electricity project? I see three of you have answered, waiting for a few more. We have 9% of you who have participated already. Thank you so much. All right, so we have 30% of you who've already participated. Lovely. I'm just going to end the poll now because of time constraints, but we'll quickly discuss what y'all have shared. The goal stage, which was not a part of the goal stage, was definitely voting for the solution. In the goal stage, the students are only working on identifying the problem. So they're building their background knowledge, they're sharing information about what they already know about the problem, they're collecting data to understand the problem in their context, they're taking perspectives of stakeholders, again, to understand the problem in their context, but they are not addressing the solution yet. So they are not voting for the best solution in the goal stage. Super. Thank you so much for participating, everyone. We are now going to move ahead from this really long goal stage to the next planning stage. The planning stage is where, okay, I'm just going to close this. Okay. The planning stage, hold on.
Before
guys,
we go
cannot
ahead,
see my, yes.
Just two questions that we have. One is, what is the duration of the activity that was conducted?
Thank you for asking. So this activity was conducted over a period of 1.5 months. The kids had classes every day. And this also, what you'll notice, is a very collaborative process. Because of that, not only were the students learning about this unit in one setting, but they were also working in different other classes. So classes like language, the skills that language was teaching them was relevant to what we were doing. So there was a lot of planning, department-wise planning that had gone on before we started the unit, which is why we were able to address the unit in the time that we needed to. However, there is something that you will notice at the end that we would have also liked to, do in this process that we weren't able to.
I have one more question.
Yeah, go. Yeah. You and I have a question. What is the age group of these children?
They were of the age group 12. Yeah, they were all 12, 11 to 12 year olds. These were all 11 to 12 year olds. Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
No question. Super. Did this flow of questions
emerge through student and facilitator discussions, or was it pre-decided?
No, absolutely. Something that we looked at is group work. So we did plan for group work also. Given that we've planned for group work, all the discussions that emerged were very student driven. The good thing about this group is that the students already knew each other, and the skills that we were working on, again, like I shared, were all going to be addressed in other settings as well. So in the moment that we were working on, the inquiry process here, right? So we were working on energy conservation in their science class or in their EVM class. We were also working on, say, speech and listening in working, how do I work with a group? What does facilitation in a group look like in their speech classes? So it was all done very parallelly that allowed the students to be able to facilitate and make it so student-driven. However, there definitely was a lot of planning that went on to all of the stages and all of the processes that we did. Absolutely. Subject integration is a huge part of the inquiry process. Okay, so with that, I'm going to quickly move to the plan stage, if that's okay with everyone.
Yeah. I think we can have one last question.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Yeah.
I just want to say to the person who had asked about the question about what is the duration. Yes, inquiry-based activities takes, you can say, 100% it takes more duration because it's a subject integration of so many subjects. But for higher classes, it's in a fruitful manner. But yes, now these days, schools are trying their experiments or they are doing the experiential learning of inquiry based in the lower grades also. So the kids' involvement is from the foundation years, like from even from kindergarten to grade one also. So I would suggest, I would just give a thumbs up to Gautami that yes, it was a subject integration, yes.
Thank you so much, Vineet. Thank you for sharing that. And I just want to add, we were saying Ms. Zeba's project does work with a slightly younger group. So the type of support that they gave them, the type of also even the steps that we use, because it was also a virtual project, were a little different. So you'll also get to experience what that looked like when we moved to Ms. Deba's project. In order to do that, I'm going to quickly move to the plan stage of my project now. The plan stage is the stage where we are looking at the solutions. Now here in the plan stage, we are only identifying and sort of framing our solutions. We are not working on our solutions. The first thing that the students did, just like we did in the goal stage, was research. So the students researched on the solutions that already existed. How they did this was first by looking at the goal that they had defined. They identified four big needs that came out of those of that goal. The four big needs that they were able to identify from their goal statement, from their problem statement in the goal stage, was to reduce consumption of electricity, to maintain the use of AC in school, and also to contribute. It was a duty of school members to contribute to global warming, and to spread awareness. These were the four needs that they wanted to work on. In order to do this, they did a little research on solutions that already existed that addressed these needs. I'm going to quickly show you how the students listed the solutions down. So like you saw through research, by watching videos, the students identified quite a few solutions from different parts or from different resources that they and different areas that they used in order to be able to list down varied solutions that already existed in different spaces that address each of the needs that they had identified. Now, having done this, the students then moved ahead and combined their solutions. They wanted to now understand their solutions. Waiting for everyone to please go, put themselves on mute. Ms. Shani, can we have...
Yes, I'm just checking. Kindly please be on mute. Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
Thank you, everyone. Okay. So with that, like I said, we went to now, after researching the solutions that already existed, the students identified two solutions that they felt that they could use in school. So they researched a little bit more about what these two solutions would look like in the context of their school. In order to do this, the first solution that they wanted to learn a little bit more about was the installation of solar panels at school. They wanted to create a proposal for the same. To do this, the first thing that they did was invited experts from solar panel organizations to come in and talk about what solar panels were, what were the pros, what were the cons, what were the advantages and disadvantages. Just give them an overview, a generalized understanding of the solution of solar panels. After that, they went on to a field trip to an organization that already uses solar panels to understand the implications of solar panel in that real life setting. And finally, they brought in experts to our own school to see what the setting up of a solar panel in our school would look like. Where would it be set up? What were the costs that school would incur? How much energy would we save? And so forth. The second solution that they wanted to work on was to create an awareness song. In order to do this, they invited an expert from school who works with all the electrical appliances and who is an IT expert in school to talk about just the use of electrical appliances in school, what were the different things that we could do, the basic things that we could do to conserve energy. They also had an LED light expert, a man who works in an LED company, come in and talk to them about what the implications of using LEDs would be on energy conservation. With that, they defined their final two solutions because they said this makes sense for us to work, to do this, to bring this up in school. And the two solutions now that they wanted to work on were the proposal of installation of solar panels and creating an awareness song. So if you look here in the plan stage, they just defined their final solutions before moving on to the do stage. Ms. Eba, let's directly move on to the do stage. I know there is a poll, but I think we can, given the time constraints, we can.
Yeah.
Okay, so now they move on to the do stage. In the do stage is where the fun sort of takes place. Everything comes into action. Having defined the solutions in their planning stage, the students worked on actually now framing that and implementing their solutions and developing it in the two stage. The first solution that they had said was the proposal of solar panel installation. For this, the students worked with their language team to create a pitch using that their persuasive writing framework that they were learning in the language unit that term to convince the founder of their school in order to install the solar panels. And the second solution that they were working on that you will see in the videos is creating and composing a song, a music or song for creating awareness. To do this, they collaborated with both their music team and their language and speech team to be able to develop the lyrics, to be able to, you know, work on their pronunciations. Our students also work on a lot of their EF skills, given that they do come from, you know, they do have needs. So keeping that in mind, it was a wonderful integration that allowed us to address so many real life skills that our students also required in other settings. Here's a video of them working on their song pitch. On the creation of their song.
Of lift.
What?
Use tens instead of lift, huh?
Use
tens. Use tens instead of lift. Yo, yo.
Right.
Of lift.
In this video, you watch the students sort of work with the speech and language teacher in the second group, where she was asking them to read their lyrics. So the students had actually created their entire lyrics and sort of were discussing what that would look like, what that should sound like, how they should practice it, and all of that. Before the students were able to finally work on their solution, they also piloted their solution to the drama teacher. I'm going to skip through this video only because I want you all to also get enough time to look at Ms. Zeba's, presentation and not tire yourselves out. Lovely, thank you so much. With that, having sort of developed their solutions, developed their lyrics, prepared their proposal, they were ready, having piloted it as well, they were ready to now finally implement their two solutions. We are going to show you the two solutions that they implemented. We have short video clips of it. In this video, you're going to see them talk to the head of school, Mr. Siomak, who was the head of school at that time, and discuss with him the importance of conserving energy and moving to solar panels. So they presented their pitch in this video to him. And in the second video, you will see the students present their awareness song in an assembly space. Please enjoy. 1 second, I'm going to play this.
So a large amount of money and the school will reduce carbon footprint.
If we install solar panels, we will generate minimum electricity of 32,000. It is the half of the price of the data electricity consumption.
But if the solar panel produces half the energy, but still in 25 years we'll save 1.5 crore.
आइए देखते हैं कि सोलर पैनल्स के बाद लगाने के बाद क्या होगा. 15,000 कोल बचेगा अगर सोलर पैनल्स यूज करेंगे तो एनवायरनमेंट को भी इफेक्ट नहीं होगा, उससे वाटर भी ज्यादा वो नहीं होगा.
एप्पल, फेसबुक एंड गूगल हैव अंडरस्टूड द बेनिफिट्स ऑफ सोलर पैनल्स एंड हैव स्टार्टेड न्यू सोलर फार्म पावर इट. व्हाट आर वी वेटिंग फॉर? लेट बी मोबाइल इको फ्रेंडली एप्स एंड इंस्टॉल सोलर पैनल.
डू यू एग्री विद अस यूजिंग सोलर पैनल्स?
गाइस टुगेदर.
Here's the song that we present.
Come on, come on, in the new black coat, who's time to say, right now?
Lovely. So with that, we reached the end of the implementation of the solution. However, the inquiry stage was still remaining. We went on to the last bit, which was the checking stage. It's important to not miss this stage only because it then does not make the inquiry process as authentic, because the students need to see how their solution worked. So it's extremely important for the students to reflect on what they have done and come back to it. We definitely understand that time constraints is a thing, and it does impact that. And we also face the same issue, to be honest. The students were definitely able to reflect with the head of school at that time on the board's decision. So they went back, spoke to him, had a meeting with him to understand what the board's decision was, what worked in their proposal, what didn't, and that gave them feedback on their solution and on their planning. However, the second bit, which was, did my conservation song have any impact? In order to do that, ideally, they would have liked to go back and look at the electricity bill of the next year. But given that the students were in the next year, some of our students were not in the group, in school. So given all of those constraints, we weren't able to go back and look at the electricity bill like we would have liked to. But they definitely did reflect and check with the head of school about their first solution. With that, we come to an end of the inquiry process of energy consumption that we did in Gateway. We have a small poll for you. We'd like for you to answer that poll. And then I know that you might have a few questions. If you would like to share that, we can open it up to that. We'll do a quick 2-minute question space so that you can also get a little movement time before we go to Ms. Zeba's project. If that's okay with everyone, I see the poll is on. So you can all start answering your poll. I just stopped sharing my screen. I see the question was, teachers made the projects contextually relevant and purposeful, the why of the learning, by applying knowledge to solve an actual problem. So clearly the teachers did not dance in order to make the project contextually relevant. All the others are absolutely right. So we did apply knowledge to solve the problem. So what the prior knowledge that we had to solve a real life problem that the students were very, very involved in and were very key stakeholders in. We also built a lot of background knowledge with about renewable resources. And finally, we looked at authentic experts and staff members that the students could interact with in order to solve the process. That's wonderful. That's honestly the inquiry process in our group in a nutshell. Now, I would love to, I see a lot of comments on chat, and I'm going to be replying to that as Ms. Eva goes ahead with her presentation. But before we do that, if everyone can take a minute to just stretch your body, get a movement break, because your brains are just sort of have been on a journey with one unit. So I think take a quick movement break and we can go on the second unit. Before that, if you all have questions, please go ahead and shoot at us.
I think once everyone's ready, we'd love to see a thumbs up or something so that we know we can move on to the next inquiry process, which is on a civics unit. Okay, lovely. Thank you, Ms. Preeti. Thank you, Ms. Gurvinder. All right, lovely. All right, I see a few thumbs up. Ms. Gomti, I'll go ahead and begin with
The
set. All right. Okay. So the second example on the inquiry process that we are going to present to you about is a civics unit. What's interesting about this unit is that we just recently ended this unit. The larger portion of this was done during virtual school. And you will notice that while we do cover the four main stages of goal, plan, do, and check, the sub-stages will differ because the age of the students and the needs were very different. So we had a younger group of students. They would be in probably a mainstream school, 5 to grade 6. That would be their age group. And let's begin. So the unit that we were looking at was democracy provides equal opportunities to all citizens. And the focus question here, the focus inquiry question was, is Gateway School of Mumbai a democratic organization? What we did was, first step was the teachers divided these stages into sub-stages. So in goal, we had three sub-stages, which were building background knowledge, researching the problem, and then defining the problem. Building background knowledge becomes a very crucial part of your inquiry process because you want students to have that content knowledge to further ask questions about what they want to inquire about. Here, with the support of the drama teacher, we had a lot of role play activities and lessons wherein we introduced the term democracy. We went into the branches of democracy and all other features that are present in a democracy. What we're going to do is show you a quick activity, a role play activity in class, which helps students understand what a democratic leader would look like. Just let me know if you can't hear it. Is it clear? Is it loud enough? Or should I put?
Can you? You haven't played it, no? Can you play it at it?
Yeah.
Me, I will promise that will not happen with you again. Okay? Because for me,
I'll vote Miss Candice. Okay? Because you had Miss Candice and me, but in round three, you're going to vote and decide who you want as your leader. All right, so you have three nominees. You have Miss Zeba, who's going to be the dictator, who's going to come in and rule the way she did in round one. You're going to, or you can choose Miss Candice, who will choose one advisor to help her in this round. Or we have a new candidate. We have Miss Darshana.
She's the best.
Miss Darshana.
Before you vote out, I want you to hear me out, okay? So I saw what happened in round one and two. If you vote me, I will promise that will not happen with you again. Okay? Because for me,
I'll vote Miss Candice and Miss Darshana.
Yes, Ishan? Can I share, please?
Yeah, ma'am. And nice haircut.
Okay. So, for me, thank you so much, Ishan. And for me, everyone is equal. So, Miss Darshana is here and all of you are here. We all are equal.
Come on, let's give feedback to Miss Darshana before class ends. What do you think? Ishan, how was Miss Darshana's leadership? Thumbs up. Can you tell me why?
Respectful. Good.
Very nice, she's respectful.
And then the others.
Then the others, okay. Yeah.
What Miss Darshana is better than Miss Ajeba and Miss Candice.
Why? You're correct, but why was she better? Can you give me a reason?
She didn't talk to us with rude voice.
Not rude, okay. What else did Miss Darshana do different? Then Miss Ajeba and Miss Candice. Yes, Abhina.
She shared the list with all of us.
Very good. She shared the list with all of you.
And she was asking.
She was not like, do whatever you want to bring
Abhina,
for
you
me.
You went on mute. You were talking and then you went on mute. So we didn't
hear. Asking?
Who can get what?
Okay.
All right. So, what we did was actually a scavenger hunt, and each teacher facilitated the round differently. And Ms. Darshana facilitated the round as a democratic leader, and that's what we wanted them to get at. We wanted them to understand the word democracy and what a democratic leader looks like. After they had gained background knowledge on different features of democracy and understood the content, we went on to researching the problem. What we did here was, through class discussions and drawing analogies between branches of the government to the different departments in the school and school system, students understood and made relevant connections between the content and the organization that is Gateway. Through guided questions and to teacher prompts, students understood that what is lagging here at Gateway is that there's an absence of student voice. So if you see the picture here, what we did was, we discussed with students that if we had to introduce a new law at Gateway, the stakeholders involved would be teachers, parents, the admin team. The school leaders would go ahead and pass the law. And then the homeroom teachers would look after and make sure the laws are being followed. However, student voice wasn't mentioned. It wasn't part of this entire process. Once students had understood and researched about this problem further, it went on to the stage of defining the problem. what you'll notice here is that in this unit, Ms. Candice and I streamlined our question and made sure we're supporting the students much more than in Ms. Bhumti's unit. That was because of the age of our students as well. So when it came to defining the problem, what we did was we asked students about what they think the problem is at Gateway, if Gateway is not a democratic organization and why. And they identified that what is lacking is student involvement. And they wanted to focus on how we can implement more student involvement at Gateway. After the goal had been set, we went on to the planning stage. In the planning stage, students first went ahead and researched an existing solutions. For this, we had guest speakers come in. We had guest speakers from other schools. So ex-students from other schools in India came in to talk to our students and talk about what a democratic school would look like. I'm going to play two videos of this.
One of them. Now, I was part of student government in both schools, but they both had a little different sort of system in which they elected their student leaders. So AVM, there was a system where the teachers select students based on their summative assessments, how are they performing in their studies. Leaders are not chosen by teachers. Teachers are not involved in the process of choosing student leaders. They are involved, but to a very little extent only. Here, the students choose who they want their leaders to be. Tell me, which one is more democratic? Do you decide to make a good government system? What are some features that a good government system should have? Should it be democratic? What kind of leaders? It should be democratic. Okay. Why is democracy better than not democracy?
Because everyone means in that everybody has freedom to speak.
And Gateway, which strategy do you think of Ms. Meera's will work? The AVM strategy where the teachers select the leaders, or the GNS strategy where the students select the leaders?
Students select the leaders.
The students select, so the students have the power to decide who should be the leader and representative.
The second video was by another student from an ex-student who was part of a student council at his school. And this is what he said.
And it had all of the rules and laws. So it's very, very cool because even though a school is much smaller than a country, the student council is very similar to something like the Indian government, and we're going to look at that today. So a student council is a link between students and teachers. I was part of the student council at my school for 3 years. The last 3 years I was at my school. Yeah, similar to the Constitution of India, a school will have a rule book or a handbook. At Hillspring, I don't have it with me right now physically, unfortunately, but at Hillspring we had this really small gray booklet that they used to give to everyone at the start of the year. And it had all of the rules and laws. So it's very similar to a constitution because when the school began, just like when the country got its independence, they decided to make a book of rules that everyone has to follow. And now that rule book has been, every year they give it to everyone. So the rule book kind of has all of the rules inside it. If we're looking at executive and judicial branch, but in a school setup, in a student council, it actually is the council's daily job. It's their thing they have to do every day. It's like, so at a school, it's smaller things. At school, the rules used to have at our school were everyone has to wear their ID card, everyone has to be in the correct uniform, everyone has to have, their hair cut correctly and things like that. And even like slightly bigger things, though, we had to make sure that the canteen was clean. If people were, wasting food or throwing food around in the canteen, we had to make sure they weren't doing that. And things like that. So very quickly, the three main attributes and qualities I think a student council should have, and many of you touched upon this, I like to call it the three C's of the student council. So there's communication, there is consistency, and there's compassion.
All right. Our two biggest takeaways from the guest speakers, one was the roles and responsibility of each member. In a democratic setup, you will make sure there's no one with absolute power. And that's one of the key features that key takeaways that our students learned about. And they understood the importance of roles and responsibilities in a school setup and in a student council. Another was how the election process takes place and how elections in a school setup is so similar to national and state elections that we see with the voting booths or the secret ballot. After the research and existing solution, and we had our speakers come in, we went on to combining solutions. Here, what was interesting was there was almost a three-way connect. So what happened was students had now connected their background knowledge and content knowledge of features of democracy to how the features of an existing student council looks like from the guest speakers. And with this knowledge, they now put it in Gateway's context. They wanted to now understand and identify what would a student council Gateway look at and what could they borrow from the content that they learned and from the guest speakers and create a solution of their own. Some of the interesting ideas that came up were students shared about how the Indian constitution being so similar to the rule book, and therefore students should be involved in even making rules at schools with the teachers and leaders. They shared how every year we could have a meeting where students could reflect on the rules and give suggestions on the changes or modification of some rules. They also identified that just like parliament sessions take place, weekly meetings among student council is so crucial to make sure communication is on and there's transparency of information. After we combined these solutions, we went on to finalizing and deciding our final solution, which was coming up with a proposal. Here, what students did was they decided that they want to write a proposal with a detailed plan of action to introduce a student council at Gateway. Miss Gomti, do we have time for a poll?
No, I think we'll skip the poll. Maybe we can come back to it at the end because we, if that makes sense.
All right, lovely. I'll move ahead to the next bit. So we've completed the plan stage. Now we go on to the do. So what we ended at was students deciding their final solution is going to be making a proposal to have a student council introduced at Gateway. In order to develop and test this solution, what students did was now they had to organize the information that they wanted to put in their proposal. One of the best things that they did was they took the features of democracy and within each feature, they decided how would that look in Gateway's context. So when it came to branches of the government, students decided this is very similar to roles and responsibilities in a student council and identified what are some of the roles we can have in a student council at Gateway. Another example would be about citizen participation. Students learned about citizen participation in democracy and how did they use this at Gateway? Is it decided while voting for our leaders, every stakeholder should be involved. So how teachers can be involved in the process, how students can be involved, and what the admin staff can do. After we had identified the points that would go in the proposal through these steps, it came to planning the proposal. Here's where the integration really came about. The language team was involved in helping students frame that proposal. The drama teacher was involved in helping students with presentation skills and how they want to present this to the vice principal of the school. And we used a grandstand space wherein students from other homerooms came together and we had a mock election take place. They wanted to pilot the solution and see whether this can be taken forward in the following year. After they had completed the stage of developing the solution, we went on to the implementation. Here, the students presented their proposal to the vice principal at Gateway. We just play a video to show you their presentation part.
We are the White Raptors. We want to create a student council for Greater School of Mumbai. Today, we are presenting the features of student council. We are presenting the student council proposal because we want a democratic school. Thank you. I want to present the three branches of government, legislative, executive, and judicial, all the three branches of the government. I think it is important to have different branches or departments because one to make law, one to pass law, one to make sure they follow law. This way, the work will be distributed evenly. Because no one is bigger than the law, no one is bigger than the law, and everyone should get the same treatment. At Gateway, we
So once the implementation stage was completed, we went on to the check. Like Ms. Gomti said, the check stage is an extremely crucial stage to make sure that it almost completes the entire inquiry process and brings it to its final end. Like I mentioned earlier, this project was just recently completed. So as part of our check, what we are going to do in January is that students are going to present this proposal to a larger group. So after they presented to the vice principal, they had a detailed discussion with her on how to take this forward. And what we reflected with the vice principal was that now students can present the same proposal to other school leaders and students. This is going to happen somewhere in January. And from there, we'll be taking this forward. And hopefully by the next academic year, Gateway School of Mumbai is going to have its first ever student council, which is initiated by our students. So yes, thank you very much. So that's how the inquiry process in the Civics Unit on Government came to an end in Gateway.
Okay, so I think Zeba Gomti, are we done with today's session?
Yes.
Thank you so much, both of you. And I think, can you share quickly what we will be doing in our next session so that we can, please.
Thank you, Shalini. So we just wanted to share with you that it was really wonderful to, one, see how much you all were discussing with us. Thank you so much for participating. I think what we want to do in the next session, since it's a reflection session, we want it to be fruitful. We want you, we want it to be, again, contextualized. Guys, in order to be able to do this, what we would like for all of you to do is go back, look at a unit in your textbook, in your curriculum, or just any unit that you may be working with in order to maybe think of planning for that. So maybe in the next session, what we are looking to do is just discuss with you, brainstorm on different ways that you can actually take this back to your classroom. And in order to make it like as authentic as possible to you, please bring back a lesson plan or a or a unit from your curriculum that you're working on for it. We also have a list of resources that we are happy to share with you. These are just links of different websites where they have done that, where different inquiry process projects have been planned. We feel like you can use this as reference. You can use it. It's even possible that you may have a unit in your curriculum that has a similar that can be converted into a similar inquiry unit as you have seen in one of the websites. So we are happy to share all the links of the websites with you now. Ms. Zeba, can you please put the links on chat? We'll be sharing two documents with you that have all the links. You can go ahead, look at those links, explore. If you like any topic from that link, you can bring that back also for the next session to discuss. But the idea is we want you to come with one unit that you really want to work on so that it can be really, beneficial and really fruitful for you. So, I think with that, we are done.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you so much, Seba and Gumti. I don't think I have any right now, any point or any words to, you know, thank you both of you. I think the participants were really, very participative. They participated and they shared their reflection. At the same time, questions also during the session. So thank you so much, everyone. And we hope if you have any, whatever the points or a few different assignments with Gumti and Seba have shared for the next session, you will going to work on it, because this is an opportunity for us to understand how we really can use inquiry in our classroom. And it is tough. I can understand there are different contextual problems with us, looking at the kind of schools where we are, but definitely Zeva and Gumti can provide all necessary suggestion and feedback for us. So looking forward for all of you in the next session with all your questions and your assignment. Okay. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Anything else you want to share?
Thank you, Zeva and Gumti. It was really very enriching, and we really enjoyed the videos that you shared of students. I do hope that people are inspired to take this up and share their own ideas and work on their ideas in the next implementation session. We really look forward to you. And that is the essence of learning. Please understand that, you know, just listening to it, I don't think you will be able to take it so much into the... Yeah, so I was just suggesting that it would be really nice to have everyone participating in implementation reflection session and to share and create their own ideas, because a lot of learning happens from that. That's all. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, everyone, for participating so wonderfully today. It was absolutely a pleasure for both Ms. Eva and me to work with you all today. Thank you.
Thank you very much.